Hey, good morning, everybody. It's great to be together today. It looks like we might be going camping or something. I think that's for VBS tomorrow. We're going to be doing some decorating later today, but kids will get to find out what that is, and any volunteers who might be helping with VBS, you might get to know more about what's going on this week in VBS that starts tomorrow evening, but there is a VBS meeting today, right after the morning service, for any volunteers who are already signed up, and maybe for anyone who hasn't but is interested in camping. You might be able to just show up to the meeting and find out if you could be used. If you're available in the evenings this week, that's an opportunity out there. Later this morning, we're going to be observing communion. And so our song that we're starting with this morning is one that has us thinking about our Redeemer as we prepare our hearts for that.
Thank you.
Lord, today we gather and we thank you for your sacrifice. We thank you for how it changes our lives, for how we have this opportunity to respond to what you've done for us. Even before your sacrifice was made, that you planned it all, that you desired to save us. And we just ask that as we meditate on and think about the things that you've done, that you would draw our hearts to respond to you, to desire you as you have revealed your love for us. Guide us and use us this morning, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Good morning. If you are able, would you please stand with me in reverence of God's word? I'm reading Deuteronomy 6, 4 through 9. Hear, O Israel, the Lord is our God, the Lord is one. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your might. These words, which I am commanding you today, shall be on your heart. You shall teach them diligently to your sons, and shall talk of them when you sit in your house, and when you walk by the way, and when you lie down, and when you rise up. You shall bind them as a sign on your hand, and they shall be on the frontals of your forehead. You shall write them on the doorposts of your house and on your gates.
Thanks, Jenny. Have the worship team come up as we sing together along that theme of God's commission to us to remember his instructions and to live them out. And we pray that Jesus would be glorified today and that we would be able to shine his light. Let's sing number 431 together.
Our faces display your guiding hand, ever
guys can be seated at this time. Our service will be a little bit of a different order today because we're going to have lots of special things and updates and making sure that we are all on the same page and knowing what's going on in this time of transition and all that. So what I want to do right now is just share some updates with you and pray about those, and then Jim Hennessy is going to come up and share some thoughts with you guys as well. Some of you may not have been at our recent business meeting, and so I just wanted to cover some of those things so that we all are caught up with that and share some new news with you guys as well. So as you guys know, we've been planning to have a period of an interim pastor ministry as we take the time to search for our next full-time minister. And we've been working with an organization you guys may have heard, IMI SOS, and they specialize in that interim ministry. Some things that they shared with us a little while ago, they had a little seminar for the church leadership that was back in March or April, I think it was March. And some things that they shared with us about churches that are looking for new pastors, there's some common mistakes that often get made. One of those, you might guess, is of looking and right away, finding somebody right away, and then realizing later that this guy doesn't quite fit with our body, and he wasn't the right guy for this body, and there's this conflict, and things usually don't work out when you jump in too quickly to searching and selecting the first guy that comes along, right? And so that's one of the reasons why there's this recommendation for this interim time period where you have more space to look and plan and think about some of those things. But there's another common mistake that can happen, and that one I thought was a lot more challenging to me as I've stepped into a role as elder here. And that is that oftentimes churches can call a pastor and then ask him to make changes and set the vision for the church. And man, that sounds really good to me. Like, oh, here's a guy that knows a direction we can go, knows how we can grow, knows how we can do this, and he's going to come in and give us all the plans and ideas. But if you think about that, you for a while, you might come up against a challenge that lies there and why that might not work, especially in a church that's long established and been here and done things the way they have for a while. What happens when a new guy comes in and tells you what to do? There will inevitably be some people who don't agree with that, right? And so often this can result in rejecting the new pastor's ministry, even when you took a little more time to get the right guy, right? And that's way more challenging to me, because what that means is that the leadership of our church has the responsibility during this interim time period to also set the vision for where we want to head as a church, so that when the new pastor comes in, he can be welcomed into a healthy, functional, spiritually vital church, and we've created a healthier, more effective church in order to welcome him in before that step happens. And so that's one of the main reasons why we're looking at this time period of interim ministry. And one thing I'm realizing is that it's placing a lot of responsibility on us elders, and I'm so glad we have a team, because there is a lot of hard work that is coming up right now in this in-between period. And so definitely be keeping us in prayer. IMI SOS laid out four phases in the transition from one pastor to the next. And I want to just kind of share with you where we're at in that, so you know all those details and can pray for us and with us and be part of that. Phase one is complete. That's farewell to the parting pastor. We did that at the end of June. And phase two is where we're at right now. That is welcoming an interim pastor and having this period of self-study. Who are we? Where are we? Where do we need to go? And visioning, planning for the future. What steps do we need to take as we prepare to welcome our next pastor? So that's really where we're at right now. Phase three then would be calling the new pastor and saying farewell to the interim minister. And then the phase four is welcoming that new pastor and continuing to implement your vision and mission. So there's a little breakdown. If you're a guy like me that likes to have things numbered and stepped, we're in phase two out of four as we welcome an interim minister and plan for the time in between and do that self-study. Self-study and visioning takes two steps. You have to assess your health and say, who are we honestly? And then you have to achieve health by looking at biblical patterns and saying, what steps could we take to be a little closer to what the Bible lays out in our mission, in our ministry, in our discipleship, in our fellowship, in our worship? And so that's what's coming up next, especially as for the elders, as we look at those things. Jim's gonna, when he comes up, he'll share a little bit more about what the very next piece of that is. And there's a part that each one of us gets to play in that. So he'll share a little bit more about that with you. But next I wanted to just share about the interim update, because I've heard some questions, and we want to make sure that everyone gets those answered, and so we all understand what's going on there. It's been really valuable hearing feedback from each of you. I've heard some comments on our guest speakers and what you've liked and not liked, and getting to hear that. Thanks to each one who passed on those pros and cons in the things that you've heard from our speakers. The past 3 weeks have been a trial period for the interim period, and make sure you understand there's two things going on there. Like, there's the trial period, and then there's an interim period, and then beyond that is a permanent minister. IMI SOS wanted us to hear and feel out Pastor Gould to see if he'd be a good fit for our interim period. For some clarification, I've heard this question from some people. IMI SOS specializes in assisting with interim periods only, and the periods in between permanent pastors. And so they do not allow any of the pastors who work with them to candidate for permanent positions in those churches. So none of the people that they send us are being considered for permanent ministry here, but they still want the in-between guy to not be in conflict with the direction of our church, and to make that we can make sure he's someone who shares the word effectively and is capable. And so that's what the last few weeks have been about. Overall, in considering Pastor Gould, I think there's been a lot more positive feedback and observations than negative. But I will tell you, I do not think he's perfect. And, you know, you're welcome for that deep insight. You know, I think that takes like a bachelor's degree in Bible theology to be able to tell when people are not perfect. That's a joke. No. Judy Gammon reminded me, I was talking to her, that, you know, that's why we have forgiveness for all those people who are not perfect. And that's a really good reminder. But one thing that we have seen is that he handles the Word of God with respect and conviction. And something that the elders have seen is that he has a calling from God to pastoring and a heart for seeing the church rise up to its calling. And in handling critique, I think he seems to be very receptive. And so I believe we'll be able to work through issues and challenges that arise in the future. And so the search committee has decided to move forward. As long as everything checks out in the paperwork process, I think Pastor Gould will be our interim part-time minister for an initial period of 6 months. And that can be adjusted as necessary depending on how the search for a permanent pastor progresses. Pastor Gould would fill the pulpit, be available for some limited office hours, some visitation, counseling needs, wedding and funeral needs. And he would only be our interim minister until we find a new permanent pastor. He's not candidating for that position. So hopefully that makes sense to everyone and answers any confusion that may have been out there. This opens the door for our church leadership to commit their efforts to each stage of the preparation, and the current one being the self-study and visioning step. So did anyone have any questions? Did I confuse anyone? Does that a good update make sense? Awesome. So I believe he should be here next week, as long as all the contracting paperwork stuff flows through as expected. And so I wanted to just take a brief time just to pray both for him as he ministers in the next few months and for us as we have this time upcoming of looking at ourselves and evaluating where we need to grow and what we need to be about as we look for a pastor that is a fit for those things that God has, you know, both gifted us with in our strengths and also addressing some of our weaknesses too. So let's pray together for a few minutes, shall we? Lord, I just want to lift up to you today, Pastor Gould, and we thank you for the messages he shared from Scripture with us and for the things that we've gotten to discover in your word that he's shared with us. And I pray that as we go forward in this time period, that you would use him to speak to us and that you would use him to take some of the responsibility from the elders in preaching week to week, that we could be focused on the things that you've called us to. And I just pray that you would use him to guide us and that you would let your word come to life through him. And that we would take those things and use them, and that we would leave the distractions and the other things behind. May your word be at work in our lives. I want to also pray for all the church leadership team as they have this really big, monumental task ahead in studying our church and setting a vision for the future. Pray for guidance and wisdom for them. Thank you for our body and each one and their part that they've played in our group, and for the way that they've strengthened the other parts just by performing the gift that you've given them. I pray this morning that you would guide us through the rest of this service, that we would understand your will and direction for our lives. In Jesus' name, amen. I'll have Jim come up and share some more thoughts with you guys.
Morning. I'd like to take this time to acknowledge how everybody has stepped up and continued serving the Lord here since Pastor Gene and Sherry have moved. You know, when I stop to consider all that it takes to do the ministry here, I realize how much of you have all done, not only the usual, but filling in the gaps left by Pastor Gene and Sherry. Let me go through a few of those. One, managing the property with lawn care, weeding, trimming, tending the flower beds, setting the trash out every Wednesday, cleaning every week. Some have even stepped up behind the scenes to change out burned out light bulbs. The maintenance of mowers. The equipment continues to be done. Thank you. Meals have been prepared and delivered during times of need. Phone calls have been made along with visits to encourage. Prayers have been lifted up for each other. Thank you. Much thought has gone into planning every service, preparing a prayer guide and bulletin, putting hymns and announcements on the screen, scheduling the extra activities, maintaining the online ministry. Thank you. Giving financially, sometimes anonymously, meeting a need quietly and respectfully. You have shared your creativity by decorating bulletin boards, arranging flowers, often from personal gardens. Thank you. Security, some have come early to unlock the doors, the building, to turn on the air conditioning, to turn on the heat. How about those monitoring the halls and the parking lot during services for our safety? Someone stays and locks the building after everybody has left. Thank you. Many share their musical talents with voices as well as instruments, sometimes at the spur of the moment when needed. Thank you. Several have stepped up to do our children's church ministry during the service. I'm sure this is not an exhaustive list. Please know the deacons and the elders appreciate all the help. Thank you. Well, I've been asked to explain to you some of the ways that we're moving forward in our search, not only for a new pastor, but also what God may have for us in the future ministry here. This brings to mind one of the Lord's faithful leaders, Moses. He too led God's people to a new land. As leaders of Faith Bible Church, those on the search committee will be assessing the way of an acrostic, SWAT. I don't mean the military type of SWAT. I mean SWOT, which stands for strengths, weaknesses, opportunities, and threats. Let's take a moment, and as we briefly consider how that might look as I relate Moses' example to our situation. Moses had several strengths. He was humble, patient, and wise. One way he showed wisdom was by delegating leaders for the children of Israel. If you remember the story about Moses, in Deuteronomy especially, the whole book is about the last time Moses is addressing the children of Israel. If you can remember that also, the setting is all of the people that were able to fight were wiped out in the 40 years of wandering in the wilderness. And the kids that came up, or the men that came up, Moses is addressing now just before they go into the promised land. So Deuteronomy 1:13 says, "Choose wise and discerning and experienced men from your tribes, and I will appoint them as your heads." Faith Bible Church also has people who humbly and obediently follow the leaders, who speak to teach others to seek God. However, Moses did have weaknesses as well. Fear was one of them. Do you recall when God spoke to Moses out of a burning bush? What was he doing? He was tending his father's sheep in the desert. He was hesitant at first to speak when God gave him his instructions. Exodus 4, verses 10 through 12 says, This is Moses speaking back to God. Please, Lord, I have never been eloquent, neither recently nor in time past, nor since you've spoken to thy servant. For I'm slow of speech and I'm slow of tongue. What might be some of our weaknesses? Do we fear reaching out, trying something new and different? Moses had so many opportunities. God spoke the Ten Commandments to Moses to share with God's people. And we still model our lives in accordance with them. He was given the privilege of leading them to a new land. Exodus 3:8 says, I have come down to deliver them from the power of the Egyptians and to bring them up from the land to a good and spacious land, to a land flowing with milk and honey. Faith Bible Church has opportunities to teach others what God has taught us. We need to look for ways to seize the new land, perhaps reaching out more to the lost and growing in our own personal walk with God. Lastly, we are to look at the threats. What discouraged Moses and became a threat to the nation was the grumbling of God's people. Exodus 17:3 says, why have you brought us up from Egypt? To kill us and our livestock with thirst? This was a time Israel was grumbling about not having any water. What about Faith Bible Church? What threats come against us? Ephesians 4:25-26 reminds us to speak truth and settle disputes, not holding on to anger. Remembering Ephesians 4:12 as well, which says, we struggle not against flesh and blood, but against the rulers, against the powers, against the world forces of darkness, against the spiritual forces of wickedness in heavenly places. You know, I think we can personalize SWOT as individuals. This week, would you consider to pause and list your strengths, your weaknesses, your opportunities, and possible threats to your obedience? God desires for us to walk in obedience and trust Him. That will take personal and corporate prayer, so that when He prompts us, we will courageously step up in complete, confident obedience. As we have considered SWOT, or SWOT, the strengths, weaknesses, and opportunities and threats of Faith Bible Church, I see great opportunities ahead. We have incredible potential here to be used by God on this corner, in this neighborhood. Let's continue to team up and see where God will lead us next.
Thank you, Jim, for those thoughts. I'm going to call up the worship team, and let's sing together about some of those things that we've been hearing about today. In thinking about evaluation and vision, you got to stay focused on one thing, and that is Jesus. Mm-hmm. Would you stand with me, and let's sing from number 560, More About Jesus. Can be seated. I'll dismiss the worship team. Wanted to share with you guys a brief devotion. That is a dangerous thing to ask me to do. I had a message that I gave back at the beginning of July, and since I gave it, I've been kind of thinking about it and challenged by some of the obstacles that are in that. And so today I just wanted to share with you guys, in hopes that you've been maybe thinking about it too, that some of these challenges and solutions could be useful in your life. And so that message was on the Great Commission to go and make disciples, and Jesus telling us how to do that. I think there's a slide in Easy Worship, is there, Phil, on that? Can you bring up that first one? Yeah. I heard that this didn't get displayed for people watching online last time, so now it should be on a different computer and you can see it. But basically, to recap really fast, there's the Great Commission right there. Go into all the world and make disciples. How? Baptize them, and that encompasses everything that leads up to baptism. Teach them, and that means setting an example and being committed to helping someone understand something. That's a lot more than just telling someone something. Teach them to observe, and teaching someone to observe is different than teaching someone to like something or teaching someone to know something. Teaching them to observe something means that there's personal accountability, that this person is actually observing it, right? Teach them to observe everything, not just some things. Everything that I have commanded you is what Jesus said. That means being comprehensive, because if you're going to tell someone everything that Jesus commanded, that's going to take some time. It's time consuming. And it's going to be pretty deep as well, because Jesus shared some really hard things. We looked at Philippians 3:17, which says, "Join me, brothers, and observe those who live according to the example you have in us." So we're invited to join. So we're supposed to teach other people, but then we're also supposed to observe the example of others. And so we're supposed to be both teachers and learners in discipleship. 2 Timothy 2:2 says, "What you have heard from me in the presence of many witnesses, commit to faithful men who will be able to teach others also." And so we're not fulfilling discipleship unless the people that we teach eventually go on to also teach. And we have to teach people to teach for that to happen. So that, in a nutshell, is that message. If you missed it, it's online. It was the first Sunday in July. You can go back and watch it, and I hope that you do if you didn't see it, because I think there's some really deep, powerful truths in there. But I've discovered, in being convicted to live this out, which I have, otherwise I wouldn't have shared it, that there are some big obstacles in trying to do this. Can you go to the next slide, Phil? This is the same stuff, just in my own words. Instead of baptize, I said, I need to accept and obey Jesus. Instead of teach, I said, I need to grow to maturity and develop strong, committed relationships. Because if I don't do that, I can't teach anyone. I have to be open with my brothers and sisters. Otherwise, how can I hold them accountable to observing God's laws unless I am myself doing that? I have to share in a way that costs my preferences and my time, because if I'm going to share everything that Jesus told me, by necessity, I can't do that with a ton of people. It's going to take way too much. And so I have to have a small group of people that I invest in. That's going to happen. I need to be a champion of the things that I receive. That way, I can pass those on to other people. And I have to build up others' confidence in sharing if I'm going to teach someone to teach. You can go to the third slide, which is just that's the first one that I had up there. So here's some challenges that I've discovered in thinking about how does this look in my life. I think it has to be on a small scale so that I can dive in deep and so that I can be comprehensive and so that I can really teach someone to observe and so that someone can teach me to observe, right? Major challenge is time. And hopefully you guys have noticed this in other areas of life. Have you noticed how much a battle your life is with time? Universally, at least across Western culture, there is an increasing demand for your time. It's almost an oppressive force behind the use of our time. How many things would you love to do if you had time? And how many ways would you be happy to serve God and others if you had time? But I can't do everything because time doesn't let me. And how often is there a person that God lays on your heart, but weeks go by before you even talk to them? There's this way in which how we manage time and how time affects our life is just so much to deal with. And I think that's one of the big obstacles to having a serious discipleship ministry on a personal level, is that it's going to require time, and that is a really hard thing to achieve in the balance of my work life and my family life and my church life. And one of the things that I've realized in thinking about that is I think in each of our lives, there is one little portion of time that has almost maybe providentially been reserved and is open and useful for however we would use it. For many years in our church, we've had this tradition of morning and evening worship services on Sundays. And Sunday evening attendance has kind of declined. And then in the midst of COVID, I think we stopped meeting in Sunday evenings. And one thing that I've realized, though, is that on Sunday evenings, since that was kind of part of the pattern of my life, I never go to work on Sunday evenings. I have Sunday off, and I think almost all of us do. And I'm never engaged in like regular things in my schedule because there was those Sunday evenings that I used to always go to. And so I've discovered that for me, and I think for almost everyone in this room, there is this time in our week on almost a consistent basis on Sunday evenings that is not occupied by work or obligations that would take me away. And so I think that has been just something that God kind of has laid on my heart to share with you. If you feel called to doing this ministry of discipleship, just meeting with somebody and holding each other accountable to spend time in God's Word and sharing what you've discovered in God's Word and using that as an opportunity to do those things that are on the screen, I think there is an opportunity for us. And I wonder if God even had that planned, that He made it in a providential way available. And so that's something to think and pray about if you feel that calling towards discipleship. The depth of wisdom and experience in this church, that's something I've been thinking about. We are, for the most part, a mature, both spiritually and otherwise, congregation. And I think that is a very powerful, important thing. There's a legacy in this church of putting biblical principles into action and living for years as someone who is committed to Christ. I don't think there's a lot of other churches that you could go to where you have the percentage of that we do in this church. And that is a really powerful thing. Do you see younger Christians who are weak and struggling? Maybe not in our church body necessarily, but have you noticed that in your life, that younger Christians seem to have a lot of challenges in their lives these days? I think that's an opportunity, especially for who we are as a mature believing church. There is no excuse for them not to receive the insights and wisdom that I have, that you have. There is also no other way that they will get it unless it comes to them from you. The potential for growth that would come from the sharing of biblical wisdom and the experience in this church, I think, is definitely larger than average. And so I would just challenge you with that. If you feel like you are someone who has matured in your faith and you have things that you see missing in the lives of people around you, I believe that probably that's a call from Jesus. One more way to apply this. I really believe that mostly this is a personal thing that each member of the church lives out in their lives. But one of the closest ways we have in corporate church programming to live out these principles starts tomorrow, and it's VBS. Because in VBS, you get to interact with the kids on a daily basis, not just a weekly basis. It's a little more comprehensive. That's one of the things that is involved in discipleship. And so, if you have no other ideas about how to jump into discipleship ministry, but you're able to volunteer for VBS, then I think there's an opportunity there to put into practice that Great Commission. And VBS is one of the few times where we can, as a body, be more involved in that. Most of the time, I believe, discipleship has to be on an individual level. So those are some thoughts that I just wanted to share with you guys as I've been thinking about how to live this out. And I hope that gives you some ideas, and I hope that gives you some tools. And the reason I want to do that is because really that is what the calling of an elder is to equip the saints for the work of ministry. And it is our job as members of the body of the church to do the work of ministry. And so as an elder, I just wanted to share some ideas for how can live that out. So those are my thoughts, and I'm going to have Cody come up and share with you some things that have happened in our church recently, and I wonder if any of the things that he will share with you have the potential to be useful in discipleship ministry. So as you hear about some of the new opportunities before us, be thinking about, does this connect at all to discipleship?
Good morning. As most of you know, one of our church members, John Miller, passed away a number of months ago. But he requested that all of his tools that he owned that were still left in his garage be donated to Faith Bible Church, which was a huge, sizable gift. And so Mrs. Gammon has been diligent in documenting all of those and getting those prepared to be moved over here. And this past week, I had a couple friends help me out, and we were able to move those to the church property. They still have to be sorted through and organized, but lots of things like sockets and wrenches and hammers and all sorts of useful things. Most of the tools on the property here in years past were actually belonged to my dad. And so now that he is gone, the church has very little practical tools that are useful for repairing cars and doing all sorts of maintenance work around the property. So it's a huge blessing to have them. And Mr. Miller also requested that the tools be open for everyone's use, and so that they would be a library of sorts of tools for any folks in the church that have a need, maybe a car repair, maybe a quick oil change, or whatever the need may be, that they can come to the church and have those tools supplied to them. So that's a huge blessing, and so I am personally very, very grateful for both Mr. Miller's donation and then Mrs. Gammon's time. She's invested quite a lot into organizing all that for us. And secondly, I wanted to just real quick mention that we have a volunteer opportunity coming up at the end of the month. For a long time, our church has partnered with the Lansing City Rescue Mission, and they are expanding, they are growing, and their ministry is growing rapidly. And I had gone down to the mission once when I was a little, several times as a little kid to play music. As of recently, went down with Mr. Humphrey maybe a year and a half ago or so, but that's it. So just on a personal level, I've gotten to meet with Mark Chris, this is on a number of occasions, and just to discuss more about what the mission does. And so that's been actually really exciting. It is really, the needs that they serve are really real and impactful, and I think it's a great way. Sharing food and sharing a bed is a great way to share the love of Christ with someone. And so the volunteer opportunity at the end of the month is for us to come down and to help serve food at the men's shelter. That would be Sunday the 27th from roughly 6 p.m. to probably 8:45 p.m. is what the time would take for that. I put a sign-up sheet in the foyer. So if you're interested, that's again Sunday the 27th from about 6 p.m. to about 8:45 p.m. I'll have more details in the future as far as navigating going over there. I think we'll all write in the church van together. But it'll be a really cool time to speak with the Lansing City Rescue Mission staff, as well as actually get to meet some of the homeless people in our community real quick, and just to do a really simple task, serving them food. I think it'll be very meaningful to me, and I'm looking forward to it anyhow. And I guess that's all of the announcements I have, but I just wanted to really quick say a quick thank you to the folks that have been helping out with the mowing the grass, weed whacking, and pulling weeds. My dad has helped out. Mr. Wright has helped out on a number of occasions mowing. Colton has helped out. Jaylen has helped out with that. And Micaiah Boy has learned how to drive the lawnmower, and he's mowed the grass on several occasions this summer. So I'm real thankful for all the folks that have helped with that. Also, someone whose name is not on this list, but has helped out in many, 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 many times in many, many ways, is Mr. and Mrs. Hennessy. So thank you all. I appreciate it very much.
Things you want to say as we prepare for communion this morning. I just wanted to do a devotional thought with you here as we think about all the things that have been said this morning and kind of wrap it up and tie it in a bow and just try to understand what it all means together. And I appreciate Jim and Gino and the things that they have said. I think fit well what I want to say as well. And one of my thoughts kind of originated from a statement that Pastor Gould made last time he spoke here. And he said, quote, "Without his vision, we rarely go outside our boundaries." And boundaries are usually a good thing. Usually they're healthy, right? Boundaries are can be defined as a limit of subject or sphere of activity. So they limit us. Boundaries typically. We have home properties and county and city and national boundaries. And it's good when you don't go onto your neighbor's yard and cut down their tree. Right? They would usually don't know you're happy about that. So you stay on your own property, stay within your own boundaries. And when nations stay in their own boundaries and they don't go on to another nation's boundaries, then there's usually peace and there's not war. So the boundaries are good. There's relational boundaries. You can only get so close to me, you don't want to invade my space because then that becomes uncomfortable. So there's boundaries we have in our relationships, both physical, but also with, sometimes you're not allowing someone to treat you in a certain way. There's, I'm not gonna settle for that. It's a boundary. Or we may have young people may have sexual or emotional boundaries that they place on members of the opposite sex, not to protect their purity. There's boundaries in our lives all the time. And they're healthy, but those kind of boundaries are the kind of boundaries that are designed to not let something or someone in, okay, keep them out. But as we think about the idea of boundaries, there's this verse in First Chronicles that has to do with the prayer of Jabez. And I'm sure you have heard that before. Not a new passage, but it does have also to do with our second reading, and I'm going to read that with you. And if you want to put that up, Phil, you can follow along on there. But this biblical concept of boundaries is a little different than keeping somebody out. It's about expanding our territory or expanding our boundaries. And that's a very important concept for us to have. And so as we can see that together, here's this First Chronicles is a genealogy, okay? It's talking about all the children of Israel and their sons and their sons and their sons. And this one particular genealogy is about Judah and his sons. And so I know sometimes, perhaps if you read through the Bible, you can get into those genealogies. And those are kind of, okay, you plod through it and you work through that, and they go on and on. And they're important, but they're not the most exciting thing that we can be reading in God's Word. But in the middle of this genealogy, we have, the author stops and talks about this person, Jabez. And who is Jabez and why is he here? And in verse, I'm going to read that in a second here, because he talks about this in light of this genealogy, and they just stop and focus on this one person. person. And why do they do that here? And it says that in verse 9, Jabez was more honorable than his brothers, and his mother named him Jabez, saying, because I bore him with pain. Now Jabez called on the God of Israel, saying, oh, that you would bless me indeed, large my border, and that your hand might be with me, and that you would keep me from harm, that God it may be not pain me. And God granted him what he requested. So that's the prayer of Jabez. And so this is the idea, the biblical idea here, again, opposite of what we talked about with boundaries before, and that is expanding our boundaries, expanding our borders, expanding our opportunities, if you will, for a greater influence for God. And so we have to reach beyond ourselves to do this. And so when we look at that, we tend to set up sometimes unhealthy boundaries. Talking about our neighbor's property and making sure we don't go on beyond that boundary is a good, healthy boundary. Maybe there's a relational boundary that's healthy for us. But sometimes we put up boundaries on our own self that limit us and our potential for God and our effectiveness for God. And those cannot be good, and usually are not good, because they, again, limit us in a bad way, in an unhealthy way. And examples of that can be witnessing. I'm not really good at witnessing. I'm really not a person who is good with words, and so I'm gonna let the pastor or the elders or somebody else do the witnessing, because that's not my thing. And you put a boundary on ourselves and not do the things that God calls us to do, or teaching a Sunday school class, or serving in some kind of ministry in some way. We put boundaries on ourselves because we don't think we're good enough, or that we don't have that gift. And so we do that, and that's not always healthy. And so as you think about that, I want to talk about Jabez, and quickly, as we just think about his life, he was doing something special, because it says he was an honorable man. And they pull him out of this list of sons, and it said, they stop, and they said, let's talk about Jabez here a little bit. And he was more honorable than his brothers. And so the question is, was it because of who he was, or because of what he asked for? Is that why he's in Scripture? And I think it's because it's both. Is that he was a man who was more honorable, and he lived in such a way that reflected God's values. And that is what God is calling us to do, reflect his values and his truth. And so when he did that, he not only was pulled out and highlighted in Scripture, but then it's important too, because he asked for something. He wanted something more, and he asked for something more. And as we read from that passage, he had this unique prayer, and I really like it when he asked for this. He says that you bless me indeed and large my border, and that your hand might be with me, and that you would keep me from harm, and that it may not pain me. There's a lot encompassing that, and I won't go into all that, but for the sake of time, but I want you to know that there's a lot there that we can chew on. And because the Bible says in James 4:2, it says, if you had, you do not have because you do not ask. You do not have because you do not ask. And we have to ask. God wants us to ask, right? He tells us to ask. And so as we read that, we know that we cannot do anything on our own strength. We hear that time and time again. We've heard that before. And so we know that we have to ask God, and we need his strength and his help. But sometimes we forget that. Sometimes we don't do that. And Jabez, not only was he honorable, but he took the time to ask for something from God. And God, of course, was willing to grant that for him. And so what are we asking for in Faith Bible Church? As we think about all these things we've heard today, and as we think about our transitional period, and what we're doing right now in this time of our church history, well, we're asking God to bless the work of our hands. That's one of the things that Jabez asked, bless me. And how can God bless us? He can bless us with the work of our hands, with the things that we are doing, not just always the physical work, which is important. Mowing that lawn is more important to keep up God's house, but also just the ministries that each one of us are involved in. Bless the work of our hands. And God would cause us to see outside of ourselves, expand our mission, and also see a field that is white unto harvest, as Jesus said. What is our mission? What are we doing to glorify God? And that God would protect our little flock. You know, we know there are wolves, that the Bible says, that are out there. And we need to be protected from harm. And we can be protected from the outside influences that we know are very real, that will distract us from our mission. but also we can protect us from internal divisions and jealousies from ourselves, right? So God protect us from those things. And so expanding our boundaries, what does it look like for Faith Bible Church? That's really a question that we have to answer ourselves when in the next few months as we talk about what our mission is and what our vision is. And so we are a church that's made up of people. It's not programs, it's people doing the work of God's that He's called us to do. And we have each of us that need to be asked what it is that we need to do. So this is both personal and corporate, as the other gentleman said. This is something that we have to do in a personal way. We each have to grapple with these questions ourselves, as well as in a corporate way. So may we ask personally what God will have me to do, and then ask corporately what He'd have us to do. And so let's pray about that as the men come forward and prepare for communion. Father, as Jabez prayed, Lord, and that at the end of that prayer, You granted his request. Lord, we just pray that You would grant us that request that we have for You to bless the work of our hands, that You would expand our borders, our territories, our opportunities, that we would serve You in a way that is honoring to You, and that You would keep us from harm, and You keep us from the evil one, and that keep us from ourselves when we allow ourselves to get in the way of what You're doing. Lord, we just pray that You would protect us, but You'd also spur us on to greater things for You. And we just know that, Lord, when we ask, that You will in return give, because You are a gracious and loving God. And we do ask with hopefully proper motives for what that we're doing lines up with Your vision and Your mission for our church. We pray these things in Christ's name. Amen. I'm going to have actually Wayne, if you wouldn't mind, pray for the bread as we think about communion this morning.
Thank you, Lord, to partake of the bread that is symbolic of the body that was broken on Calvary's cross. Father, we think of our Lord Jesus and the great sacrifice that He made to pay the price for our sins. And Father, as we partake of this bread, we pray that You would help us to do it in a worthy manner, so that we might not bring shame to the cause of Christ, but we would lift Christ up in our lives as we go forward. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
to come together in communion because it's a time together, a time that we need to come together as a church and be unified and to celebrate the Lord's table in view of the way that we, keeping in mind that the way we serve something and someone greater than ourselves. And so as we think about that and we think about the sacrifices of the Lord and to eat and drink to a covenant sealed by his body and his blood, I pray that we would take this with that in mind as we eat the bread that is broken for us. And after they ate the bread, which is his body, and when they had taken the cup, they gave thanks. Thank you, Lord, for shedding your blood for our salvation.
Want to spend a little bit of time together in prayer as a family. There's lots in our future that we've talked about. There's lots going on in the lives of our church, and there's lots to think about and meditate on. Hopefully you got some great things to chew on as we prepare to go to lunch, that something that was said today could be something that you bring up in discussion, that, hey, what do you think about God speaking through this thing in my life? Or take something that you heard today and let it continue on as we celebrate and share our lunch together today. I'll open us in some prayer for our future, and then Jim, you want to pray for some people in the church, and then you can close, Jeff. Lord, we ask you to prepare us and to guide us. We pray for the future ministry of this church, that you would help us to fulfill our mission of glorifying you. Forgive us for the ways that we have failed to evangelize. Build us up and strengthen us for that task. Forgive us for the ways that we have failed to disciple others around us. Help us to reach out and to take that step and to initiate. Help us to continue strong in our worship. I pray that you would be preparing somebody who is our next future pastor. We do not even know who this person is, but we ask that you would be preparing them and working in their lives. Help us to be preparing for them. Guide us into the ways that we need to grow. Strip away from us the things that are getting in the way of us living as you want us to live. And turn us into somebody you can use, to a church that is healthy and producing fruit for you. As we get ready for VBS this week, help us to be active in this ministry of reaching out to these kids and to guide them and to share with them the difference that you've made in our lives. Pray all these things in Jesus' name.
Our dear Lord, as we come before you, we want to remember those in our congregation that have many needs. And I think of George Bishop, Lord, as he has some health issues that have been very serious for him this last month. And I ask that your will be done in his life, that if it is your will, that you would spare his life, that he would be brought back to health. I remember Judy Gammon has this Thursday, she has surgery for a biopsy. We ask that you, Lord, that you would walk with her, that you would have the peace as she goes through this, and assurance that you are with her. I also remember, Lord, Doug Glockson as he's working with his family in caretaking, and the consideration that he has to go through now for the health needs that they have as well, that you would be with him as he makes this decision. And also, Lord, with Bonnie Kleiss, as she has a constant health issue, may you work with her and Phil as they contemplate how to try to resolve and make decisions from what the advice of the doctors are. And last, Lord, I ask that you would be with the leadership here as we lead and move in the direction that you would have this church go, that we would never forget you, Lord, and give us the blessing that you want us to have as a church body and with each other. In Jesus' name.
And Father, as we close, and I just pray in agreement with my brothers this morning, and in a corporate way, just ask you to do something special here, Lord. Nothing that we are special and we are unique, but we're just a body of believers coming together for the purpose of glorifying you and serving you and ministering in ways that we might do together, Lord, to further your gospel and be a light to this community, Lord. And I just pray, as we thought about perhaps this day, about things about discipleship, about how we might duplicate ourselves by reaching out to someone who can be encouraged and instructed and taught, Lord. And just as I pray, as we think about expanding our borders, expanding our opportunities, thinking beyond ourselves and even thinking outside of the box about what are you doing in this world, in this present time, Lord, that is perhaps unique. There's been challenges throughout history, Lord, and yet as we have a sense that perhaps your coming is drawing near, Lord, I just pray that we are thinking about what it is you're calling us to do and what is it that is distracting us from our mission. Personally and corporately, Lord. And I just pray that we would be thoughtful and prayerful about that individually again, and then also as a church, a body, Lord. So I just pray that you would move in our midst, that your spirit would instruct us and show us what we have to do, and that like Jabez, who was different and he was more honorable, Lord, that we would live honorably in this present world. Because, Lord, when we stand up for truth in this world, we are going to stand out because of the fact that there's such an attack on truth. And, Lord, we know we have your truth. It's not our truth, it's your truth. And we just pray that we'll live it out and we'll have the strength to stand on that. And when we are attacked for that, Lord, we will just take that in with a grace and just give you the pressure of holding that burden and just knowing that we are just called to be obedient. And I just pray that you'd help us to do that. Bless our time together in fellowship and in this meal that we're going to partake of together, and that it'll be a blessing to us and to you. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Amen. How the worship team come up as we prepare to close today. Lunch is provided. If you did not know about that, it is no problem because it is all ready for you. So feel free to stick around and join us for that afterwards. We're going to close with number 425. Would you stand with us as we sing together, bind us together.
Bind us together, Lord, bind us.
The VBS meeting is going to be right in here, right after this prayer time. So if you'd like to be part of that, stick around for that before joining us for lunch.
Would you bow with me, please? Lord, would you bless each and every family person here today, that we would live out our lives to bring honor and glory to you. I pray in Jesus' name, amen.